is a beautiful, easy read. And those were genuine emotions at the end of it, to be honest. Like, yeah, I'm really close with my siblings. I don't get to see them that often. And it just brings you back. It's something so simple, you know, the wording isn't like verbose and trying to be, you know, anything bigger than it is. But it's such a simple, you know, easy day, but just so, like, things that are just so pertinent to be taken aware of.
I just picked up a typo. It just says you uncle too. But I mean, this is amazing. This is the story that like connected, or at least that I connected to the most, you know? Like sort of living at home with relatives, like family relatives that are like in your space, and you sort of feel that, you know, cause you go to school and you know, your friends at school or whatever are like, yo, my brother, my wife. And for me, all I have is uncles and cousins and all that shit. And they're all in your space, 24/7, wearing your fucking boxes, fucking eating your cereal, fucking up all your shit. But the thing is, I guess that's how I learned to share, if you get what I mean. Like ownership became like a secondary thing. Like I don't own anything. Everything belonged to me and my family and my friends and whatever. But this story for me, I connected to so hard, bro. Cause we, you know, like I remember even visiting you and like running into some of the uncles that were hogging the TV. You couldn't really do shit. It was just this mysterious being that was just there. And you know, and calling shots. It wasn't even like you could call shots, the shots were being called for you. So this story was beautiful to me, man, because it also, you have to understand that like family comes first, you know. And the whole concept of family is greater than the concept of me.
I want to do that again.
Nah, dude, what was the
joke? Okay, cool.
The joke, why do you like the story so much?
The story?
Yeah.
It's relatable, dog.
It is.
It's relatable. Like I told you, there's something like, so Albert Camus, you've read The Stranger.
Yeah.
And like I said, like his treatment of suicide is very flippant.
Yeah.
And I feel like that's what you did here. Like it was very flippant. Like, ah, fuck, I'm going to kill myself. But I'm going to see my friend before I kill myself.
Yeah.
So fuck it. Nah, dog, I really enjoyed it. And I really enjoyed the story, dog. Like, proper.
And the Fatuous state of severity, what does that mean to you?
Like, I mean, it's a pretty absurd title, but I think you did that on purpose. Because, like, when you read the story, it's like, fuck, like, okay, cool, this dude was deliberately being, like, absurdist. Like, there's the Tumblr story where the dude jerks off, puts a dildo up in his ass, and it's like, okay, cool, like, this was like deliberately being confrontational. So, I mean, when I first read the title, it was like, fuck, okay, what's up with this?
It's so good. Did you write this? Did you create it? Is it not real? Because I would have loved to watch him.
How did you like that one?
I want to talk about The Fatuous State of Severity.
What's that?
It's a book I wrote.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a collection of short stories.
Did you like write it by hand?
Yeah, mostly. So like...
For real? Like pen and pencil?
Yeah, no, well, pen and pad.
For real?
Yeah, cause so like what happened was I was in the psych clinic for like 21 days, and because like I suffer from like severe depression and anxiety, with a proclivity towards a melancholic state, so like I got there and you know someone very dear to me really helped me get there actually, like she made all the plans and all of that. Anyway. While I was there, my boy was on the other side of the world, Nolan, and he was just like, right, the whole time. And like, I started writing, and instead of like fucking, I was like, fuck this nigga, I'm not gonna like type the shit out on my phone again, because I didn't have a laptop. So I just started voice messaging him. Like, what are they called? Voice notes. So I started voice noting him the stories, and then his responses, fuck you, don't ever send me another PDF in your fucking life. You have to read every story to me from here on out. So I was like, cool, that's dope, because I mean, this is a book and like an audio story, right? And then, so I like, I just carried on writing these stories, and like, as I went along, I gained more confidence because like the meds were breaking through and the serotonin and the dopamine were coming through, and like, you know, my brain was balancing out and I didn't want to kill myself as much. And what happened was I sent it to Kyla Four, shouts out, love only, respect. And I sent her a story and she was like, fuck you, like I have to narrate the story. Like, I want to narrate the story. So I was like, oh shit, this shit just got bigger, right? This is no longer just like a book or an audio like kind of tale. This is an actual movie. And that's why we're doing what we're doing.
The fish is difficult enough for you. The work is told and flattened and with no trace of humor. Her eyes stared coldly at him as he tried to gather himself. His mouth was again in awe of the brazen declaration. She continued to flatten him with emotional stare. Okay, but listen, you many, she interrupted. Don't try the fish. It's not for you. I'll work here. I should know. Journey from another father, he began to worry that his constant gape might be assumed and was attaching us. Wow, you fucking suck at your job, he yelled at him. Every hit in the restaurant deteriorated into the reaction. Sir, please calm down. I'm merely trying to help. She pointed to her audience. What the fuck kind of bullshit are you pulling? I really sat down, and instead of asking if I'd like to drink, you walk up to me in all the might and glory that comes with being a waiter, and instruct me on what not to order. Sir, I was merely telling you what to do and don't like. You telling me that you can read my mind and my taste buds? Okay, go ahead, read my taste buds then, you necklace ruining head of space. The manager walked over to the table as she began to cry and ran to the kitchen. Sir, they began, before I ask you to leave, I must ask you to please clarify the meaning of necklace ruining head of space. 2 weeks later, an online fundraising campaign raised 2 million quinja as compensation for the trauma suffered by the man in the restaurant. He used the money to buy a small car, which he drove into the establishment and died on the scene.
Your mom called. My uncle told me on my arrival home. She's dead. The world had become a large hole that was swallowing me. I couldn't breathe and my vision blacked out. I could see my uncle's unclipped toenails obscuring the carpet that my face lay on. They were wide, dirty, and a threat to my insecurity. His toenails were getting ready to cut my mouth open, their bloodlust evident. I tried to move, my body refused to comply with my wishes. A memory of my mother rushed at me. I was chasing her down the grocery aisle store. She was running away from me, pushing a trolley. She turned the corner before me, and as I followed to catch up with her, I found that she knocked a man over with a trolley. My mother couldn't help but giggle as she tried to help the man up. Her giggle was infectious, and the man couldn't help but smile and wave her off with her apologies. When I finally hugged her leg through her persistent apologies, the man looked down to also share a smile with me. Without warning, my mother tore through the frozen food section. I also took off, trying to close the head start that she had gained on me. And before that, she disappeared again. My mother's gone. I have nothing left. My chest was caving in, and I had to claw my way through the bathroom. I reached, but nothing came out. Between the pushing and trying to draw breath, the sense of suffocation was becoming unbearable. The more I pushed, together the vortex of air seemed to suck down my throat. Stuck in a vacuum which I allowed me to neither breathe nor in nor out, I finally expelled the tuna mayo noodles that my stomach had contained. Suddenly there was a shortage in my stomach's contents and exploded therefore. My chin rested in the toilet seat and my arms wrapped around themselves. I distinctly remember the cold of it. The fumes made me retch harder, and I felt that I could never let go of the toilet. She disappeared. I could feel my uncle standing in the doorway. He never wore any clothes in the house, and the sight of him would not have helped me in any way. I could smell his cigarette burning, and I suddenly stopped. And all suddenly stopped. I need this cigarette more than anything. I flushed, rinsed, and wiped. I grabbed the cigarette from his hand and made my way to the lounge where I sat and stared at the blank TV. A message came through on my phone. How would I be able to call him to inform him of my own sudden death? A second message. 45 years old. You need to move out of the house tomorrow. Your uncle too. I fucking hate my life.
Anyway. Gang. My favorite rap from when I was 15. So I'm gonna read this shit.
Cool. Let's see.
This is the front cover of the book. He says that the most ridiculous part of one's journey is that much like any life, it must come to an end. To not accept this simple fact is simply to reject life. So anyway, the fatuous state of severity was basically me being in the clinic and realizing how seriously I take myself and how hard it is to not exist as this walking idea of other people's projections. And I didn't want to be a projection anymore. I wanted to live my life, you know. Whether it's family, whether it's friends, whether it's people who don't know you, whether it's an online presence, whether it's anything. People already have assumptions about you before they've met you, and it's not nice. Because no one has really met each other, and we don't listen to each other anymore. We don't even speak. We don't even write. We just send letters. And when I say letters, I'm not talking about the shit that comes with a postal code. I'm talking about two and you sitting next to each other, you know? And it's just some really whack shit, because I don't think people have ever spoken before. And the fatuous state of severity is simply just the beginning of a conversation that I'm trying to have about the absurdist reality that actually comes with being a human being and being alive, and all the weights and expectations, and trying to manage that with the people around you. And I'm hurting people, but you inevitably hurt regardless. So when you hurt others. And that's something I don't appreciate about myself, and I'm gonna rid myself of it. So the back.
A dirty dick, and I'm not sure that I want that thing inside of me. Here's a tip. Take the elevator back downstairs to your apartment and stream your shower so everyone can witness you cleaning yourself. Then hold your dick up to the camera when it's absolutely clean. And then, only then, will I consider allowing you to go fuck yourself. The text ended with an emoji blowing a red heart through a kiss. He immediately regretted his iPhone upgrade. Nevertheless, he walked away from her door, took the elevator down, and streamed his shower for his entire social network to witness. He got out and held his dick up to the camera to show off how well he had cleaned it. With an audience of 200 people and a stream of comments, he looked for only one. He found it. You're finally clean enough to fuck yourself. He went off camera and returned with a massive dildo. He held it out for his increasing audience to view. But before he could insert it into his ass, his Facebook profile was banned due to the obscenities occurring on his timeline. Unaware that he had no longer had an audience, he continued to probe the lubed prosthetic deeper. A knock on the door. He answered naked, with the object still between his ass cheeks. She stood in front of him, her eyes aflame. She pushed his defined chest and slammed the door behind her. She turned him around, bent him over, and rammed the dildo as far as she could till he collapsed onto the floor, screaming as she pulled his head back and watched the rest of his body spasm. He loved it. She left the door open, leaving the sight of him stark naked on the floor in a pool of his own cum. His legs lay apart and the dildo remained erect between his ass cheeks. "Pussy is so fucking gay," he ultimately whispered to himself before passing out.
To shy away in silence by Phumlani Pikoli. I suppose there are worse things out in the world than to be bored, like being entertained at the price of someone else's life. Man, that documentary really fucked me up. But that's all right, I guess. It makes me empathetic, doesn't it? After growing up, you get less and less time to yourself and need something more than merely amusing. You need a reflective outlet that can mirror the same feelings you can get without having to be put in that situation. I wonder why we love pain so much, or at least value it. I think I've had enough for this concoction to work. 3/4 of a bottle, I'd say that's fair enough. Now to stand up from this couch and head over to the cabinet, where the real journey should begin. I wish I had stronger meds though, but what's the chance of me getting prescriptions without a medical aid card? Do you have anxiety or problems? He asked, with that fucking pump thing. Should I carry on?
Yeah.
Cool. Do you have anxiety problems? He asked, with that fucking pump thing around my arm beeping faster and louder as my heart rate caught the fit. There's no way I could get away with this lie. But as they say, once you've started something, you gotta finish it. Fuck off, you stupid nurse. I paid a good $450 for this fucking consultation and you're in the way between me and between my boredom and release. I don't, I said, the monitor beeping the fuck out. I feel like a mule being found by one of those Nazi four-legged mongrels. He smiles at me and tells me the doctor will be with me shortly. Fuck. So what's the problem? Motherfucker's not even looking at me. I stammer and mumble about the abdominal pains, cramps and such, being short of breath and having the shitters. Dude's frowning like I'm not paying for this consultation with the last money I have. Motherfucker. I have a date to catch and all your red-nosed ass can do is look at your chart. He puts on his gloves, touches me in all the places I complained about, and tells me he can't find anything and I should be fine. Without once touching his blues with my browns, dudes walks out and leaves me there feeling more useless than I am bored. Fuck. Well, I suppose I can count that as an adventure. The cabinet has this useless-ass paracetamols, fancy for panados. They say on this thing that 40 could be lethal, especially mixed with liquor. 40 could be lethal, mixed with liquor. 40 could be. Just how weak are these motherfuckers, really? I empty the container on my kitchen table, enjoying the heaviness of my coordination. There's nothing better than being drunk, sway without the unwelcome sanctimony of uninvited eyes. The strings playing in the background are perfect goodbye music too. Like, yo, when you find me here, here's a song to play at my funeral, or remember me by, whichever you choose. 40. Nah. This is why I bought a second. Going with 60, I empty out what looks like 20 more before having one last scroll through my timelines. Instagram crush after Instagram crush come up. I say goodbye with my last heart. Twitter up next. I don't open the links. I just favorite and retweet what makes me chuckle, but I'm still not entertained. Facebook. Tsepo status gives me the location of his hotel, an open invite. He's in town. Maybe it's not that far. A goodbye in person would be more dramatic, I guess. And a good story should live after it. Guess I'll choose that then. The pill stays strewn across the counter because the Uber dude is only a minute away. I'll catch them when I get back. When 40 with liquor and all else should be more than sufficient. Downstairs I go. Sure, Bongani, I say, still looking at my screen as I stay next to him. Sure, boss, where are you going? I kogu telendao, I see aguyu. Nzogbonisa. Sharp, boss, you can show me the way. That's the problem with my accent. Anyone can pick up the English in my Xhosa. Fuck. this guy isn't responsive, so I think the directions will do for him. His attitude probably comes from the fact that I'm giving him directions, which means I'm not a well-paying trip. The problem with city lights is that they're obviously fake. We can't see the stars properly because the city itself is fake. It's all of the imagination of some bigot whose name or story I'll never know, but I sure as hell know his family is still all up in my purse. Why the fuck am I so bored?
So the same character from the uncle book.
Yeah.
I'm gonna draw the uncle.
Yeah,
you wanna draw his dick closer?
Yeah, please.
My beautiful little boy. Booty, are we really so special? I asked my older brother as he held my hand and helped me cross the road. Of course we are, he said to me as we got to the other side. He looked down at me and touched the back of my head with his hand. He knew I really liked it when he put his hand at the back of my head. His hands felt so soft on my head and hard in my hands. I felt myself shake with joy and he laughed. My brother always picked me up from school. This was one of the only times we got to spend with each other. Since mommy and daddy decided to live in different houses, we couldn't live in the same house. You know you're special, Bafana. Why are you asking me such a silly question? I wanted to look up at him, but the sun hurt my eyes, and I tried to put my hand in front of them to stop it from making them sore. Booty touched my head again, and then took off his cap and put it on me. It covered my whole face, and it was dark, before he lifted it up in the front and told me to hold it. I was laughing, because he was laughing. Then he made it right at the back and I could feel it squeezing my head. It pinched me, but when he asked how it was, I said it was perfect because I never got to wear his clothes. They were always too big for me. This was my chance. He smiled at me and told me I looked like a gangster. I told him I was a gangster. Then he asked me again why I asked him that question. I don't know, I told him. It just feels like people are always looking at us. He smiled at me. It wasn't a happy smile. It was a smile I had seen on mom and dad a lot when I asked them about things they didn't want to tell me. That's a question for when you're big, Bafana. Mommy wouldn't say, and then she'd tickle me and make farting sounds on my stomach with her mouth. I would laugh so much that I'd end up really farting. Then she'd tell me she couldn't be around stinky young men. She would put two of her fingers on her nose and run away from me. Daddy told me that some of the answers I was looking for would just make me sad. You're my happy little boy. I want you to stay like that. Dad liked to tell me. He'd kiss me on the top of my head and walk away.
Cool.
I like it. I like that end part.
Cool. So,
the second part, yeah.
So just keep reading. Booty told me we could take the long way home today. He said we could walk down my favorite street. He had my bag on his back, but still he lifted me on his shoulders. I was very far from the ground and I wasn't even scared. It was hot and Booty's head was a little bit slippery, But I didn't care because I was in the top. He walked so fast with me on his shoulders that my backpack. Close your eyes, he told me when we were getting close. I closed them because I wanted the street to also surprise me. Okay, open them. Everything was purple in the street. The trees were nice enough to give the street their flowers. They even gave the grass some flowers. But it was because the trees had so much. I think that's why they were so nice. I love purple so much, I shouted. Booty said we should take a rest in the grass. When he let me down, he used his arms to make me somersault onto the grass. Then he lied down next to me. The flowers smelled so nice, and the grass also. We just lied there. We didn't know whose garden it was. Me and my friends had been chased off other people's. Some shouted and told us they would use their dogs next time. But Booty was big. It was definitely okay with him there. Booty, why did you ask me why I asked you? Why I asked what I asked you? I asked him. Why are you asking me why I asked you what you asked me? Because you asked me why I asked you why why you asked what I asked you. So now you're asking me why I asked you why you asked me why I asked you about what you had asked me. I had to close my eyes and try and remember everything we had just said. This game always made me confused because Booty was so much gooder at it than me.
I think we should go. Do you want to keep reading?
Yeah, sure. Yes, I shouted out and finally stopped being confused. Lying down, we were both looking up at the nice trees that like to give away their flowers. Through their branches, we could see the blueness of the sky. It felt like we were looking at magic. Yes, what? Booty asked me. Yes, to what you asked me. We were laughing so much today. I decided to sit up on my bum. Booty was lying down still when I tapped him on the shoulder to show him. See, all those people now are all looking at us, I said and pointed. He kind of came up using his elbows to see the passing group. They were from the Afrikaans school, not far from our house. They looked and also pointed at us. I remember asking Mommy and Daddy why I went to school so far when there was one around the corner. They smiled at me. Booty looked at them. Then he waved at them and smiled. They stopped and looked at us when Booty did this. Instead of waving back, they started to run away. Booty looked at me and smiled. It wasn't a happy one. I asked him why they were always looking at us. It's because we are very special, Bafana. So should I be happy about it, Booty? Because a lot of the time that they do it, it makes me feel funny. Booty sighed and sat up to look at me. He took his cap off my head and touched the back of my head again. My whole body shivered and we laughed. More.
Cool.
Cool. I'd like to finish reading the story, but it's long.
I mean, you can if you want.
Huh?
You can if you want. Do you want to carry on reading?
Okay, where was I? My whole body shivered and we laughed. Then he told me, Bafana, there's something you're going to have to learn sooner or later, and that is, some people don't like you and it's not your fault. What do you mean they don't like me, Booty? Was I ugly to them, Booty? Because I can tell them I'm sorry and that I didn't mean it. Booty's eyes looked like they were sore, but he was smiling. You didn't do anything wrong, Bafana. You were born the most beautiful boy in the world. I was very confused by what Booty said. Because if I was the most beautiful boy in the world, wouldn't that make people like me more? Wouldn't they love me for being beautiful? I asked him. I didn't mean to make him laugh, but he did. He laughed a lot. He laughed so much that he looked like he was crying. Did I make you sad, Booty? I never seen you cry. Booty got up and took me in his arms and hugged me tight. I think I heard him sniff. Then he suddenly squeezed me and I couldn't breathe. I tried to tell him, but then he let me go and we laughed. You know, Bafana, there's nothing wrong with people not liking you sometimes. I didn't know what Booty meant when he told me this, but it didn't sound right. Why would it not be wrong for people to not like you? Only bad people didn't want other people to like them. But then, wouldn't that make me a bad person, Booty? I asked, looking up at him from lying down in his lap. What is a bad person, Bafana? Someone who is ugly to other people. Someone who cheats, lies, and beats people up. Someone who hurts other people. It was so easy to answer his question. Why did he want me to answer something he already knew? I see, Booty said. He had his naughty smile on. I knew it was time to play a game. Let's play a little game, Bafana. Okay, I told him. I'm going to ask you some questions and then you have to answer them, okay? Okay, I always want to answer Booty's questions. Remember that time we played Crazy 8 and after I won, I showed you that I had hidden my cards under my bum. Yes, you cheated me and then you didn't tell anyone that you cheated me. You lied and everyone believed you and then you and Lumvundla teased me until I became so angry that I threw you with the remote and then you hit me. I'll never forget that. I hurt you a lot that day. You did, I told him. I felt sad and angry at the same time, like I did that day. Booty was so mean and ugly, I thought I would hate him forever. Did you think I'm a bad person? Of course I didn't think that Booty was a bad person. He was my most favorite person. But how was he not a bad person if he could do all those bad things to me? I couldn't think so fast. I could only stare at Booty, and I nearly opened my mouth. And what about you, Bafana? Remember, you also shouted at me, which is ugly, and you threw the remote at me, trying to hurt me. He spoke to me in a soft voice, and that let me know he wasn't angry. He still had his sad smile on his face. I felt sad and wanted to cry. Sometimes I get so angry that I don't know what happens to my body, and I just try to hit everything and break things. Booty is right. I am a bad person. Maybe I am a bad person, Booty, I told him. I sniffed my nose and played with my grass in my hands. I couldn't look at him anymore. No, Bafana, Booty told me, with the finger under my chin, so my eyes and his were looking at each other. You're not a bad person. It's not always easy to know who's good and who's bad. Those children don't like you because their parents have taught them to hate our parents, and their parents teach them not to like us. Eventually, they'll probably hate us, just like they have been taught to hate our parents. I didn't really understand what Booty was trying to tell me because at my school, I had friends who spoke Afrikaans at home, and they liked me, and also our parents liked each other. When I asked Booty about this, he smiled and told me, remember what I said earlier about not everyone will like you. Well, keep that in mind, because not everyone is the same. Some people are nice, others are ugly, and some ugly people are pretending to be nice, and then nice people who think they are ugly. As you learn, Bafana, you'll come to know to tell the difference, he told me, and softly pushed me down onto the grass. He lifted my untucked shirt and tickled my stomach gently with his fingers. I was looking up at through the purple spotted branches at the sky and enjoying his touch. I watched through the purple lace curtain, the white clouds swim in the blue sky. I didn't really understand what Booty was telling me anymore, but pretended to. It sounded like he was trying to tell me something important. As I listened to his voice, I thought of my bestest friend at school, Carl's older brother. I really liked her face. Older sister. I really liked her face. I once told Carl this, and he said something about my mother being pretty for a black. When he told me, it made my stomach feel funny, but it sounded like a good thing, and I agreed with him. Booty was still talking, and I tried to listen to what he was saying. You see, Bafana, they'll end up trying to tell you that it's because you're different. It won't be because of that. It's going to be because they've become to believe things about you before they've met you. They'll try to make you believe that you're the same as others, or single you out as a special case that makes you better than others. But you'll never do that. You'll refuse to be what they want you to be. I was so confused. I was angry with myself for allowing Booty's tickles to me distract me for so long. I didn't know what he was talking about, and he was talking to me like a big person. He never did that. I didn't know what to say, but I knew I had to make him believe that I was listening. He sighed a deep sigh. He asked me to sit up and look at him. I knew when he did that, he knew I wasn't listening anymore and was going to tell me to pay attention when we were talking. I sat up on my bum and faced Booty. I remember how sweet the grass smelt and the purple flowers also giving it perfume. It was a hot day, but nice in the shade. When I finally looked Booty in the face, I saw his eyes were red. I had made him feel really sad. He wasn't even smiling a sad smile. I was angry with myself for not having listened properly. I'm sorry, Booty, I started, but he didn't let me finish. Bafana, you've got nothing to apologize for. Not to me or anyone. Booty's voice was shaking and he was barely whispering as he spoke. I could feel the back of my throat was also getting sore. As he opened his mouth to speak, I could see his lips shaking and he took a sudden breath. He had tears rolling down his face and he sniffed before he told me, you're not going to be anything anyone else wants you to be because you're my little brother. You were born beautiful and you're going to stay that way no matter what anyone tries to do to you. I love you for the person you are, not for what the world will try and turn you into. Booty hugged me and I couldn't help myself. I started crying into his stomach. My whole body was shaking. I could feel Booty's body shaking too. But his tight grip let me know I was safe, and so I carried on crying like there was nothing wrong. When we finally stopped crying, Booty slowly let me go. I didn't let him go. I stayed in his lap and closed my eyes for a little bit, feeling like the most beautiful little boy in the world.
So the back of this book is called Black History Lump. And it goes something like this. I'm going to try and read this. It's even convoluted for myself, so I know my mind's a race. Ham's children were cursed into being a dark-skinned race and cast into slavery. Punishment for Ham having seen his drunken father naked. An explanation for supremacy manifests in real terms that seek to further entrench an important faith for the docile or the naive, a historical legend that qualifies the guilt of the innocent. The backstory for any couple is as important as the first or the front. The two cannot exist without each other. Hence the duality of being even more important, the multiplicity of existence. Take time to explore feeling asunder. Sunder is my favorite word. Sunder means, for those who don't know, the weighted realization that perfect strangers have an existence just as complex and full of life as you.